Well, good morning, everybody. Great to see you. My name is Simon. I get to be part of the leadership team here at East Hampstead Baptist Church. And Christmas is coming. I hope nobody's getting too fat, but Christmas is coming. And it's our new series, our Christmas series, which we're calling Brave New World. And really, it's a series about faith and courage. The courage that Mary had to have, and Joseph, and the shepherds, and the wise man, and indeed, God. And later on, Philippa is going to come and talk about Mary's story and how she had to deal with all sorts of fears and troubles. And Philippa is taking her own courage in both hands to come and preach. As I keep reminding her, preaching is the highest and the greatest and the most blessed calling that ever anyone can ever be called to. Isn't that right, Phil? So you're really looking forward to that. Okay, but first we're gonna sing a couple of songs. So we'll be about 45 minutes. I'm going to hand over to Colin now as we worship.
Holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth.
2018, I was working as a teacher in a local primary school. I had numerous responsibilities and, I have to be honest, a fairly healthy paycheck. I was financially stable and I was looking forward even more to financial freedom because my family was growing up and they were starting to leave home. After many, many years of struggle as a single parent, the future was looking quite rosy. And then I was asked if I would consider changing my job. Now, some of you may have heard what happened next, because the job I was asked to consider was here at the church. It was a part-time position on a dramatically reduced salary. So I wrestled with this for weeks, coming no closer to an answer. Should I pack in everything that I was doing or continue where I was with the financial stability that I had been longing for? And I couldn't think straight. So eventually, I put out a challenge to God. Whether that was right or not, I don't know, but that's what I did. Now, I said, if somebody unconnected to the church says, you'd be great at that, Phil, you should go for it, then I would apply. Now, imagine my shock when another member of staff at the school I was at saw the job description on my laptop one lunchtime. You'd be great at that, Phil, they said. You should go for it. You know, God couldn't have been any clearer. So I applied, thinking that was all I was being asked to do. I had no expectation of getting the job, but did as I was told, and I applied. Now, fast forward that a few weeks through a grueling interview process, and I was offered the job. But it was for less hours, or for fewer hours than I had expected, and therefore a smaller salary. Could I do it? Now, although my kids were older, they still needed me, and I still had bills to pay and financial commitments. Well, the fact that I'm here is a bit of a giveaway to the end of this story. See, I decided to trust God and made the jump from my full-time teaching job to work part-time for the church. I was terrified. The reality of giving everything up hit hard. Would I be able to do it and still meet all my obligations? Now, I can honestly say that although times have sometimes been tough, especially last year when somebody very kindly totaled my car, God has been faithful and he has provided. Now, he called me to something completely different, completely unexpected, and something completely outside of my comfort zone. But I trusted him and he kept his promises. Have you ever experienced a sudden change in circumstances? Whether relational, emotional, or financial, these changes can make us fearful and uncertain. Have you had your expectations turned upside down? Well, today, we're going to be thinking about someone whose circumstances changed dramatically and irrevocably. And we find out what happened in Luke's account of Jesus' life right at the beginning in chapter 1, starting at verse 26. And it says this: in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord will give him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "Well, how can this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible for God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. Here we have this young woman, probably a teenager. She's going about her life. She's expecting to get married. She's expecting to take her place in society. And God's messenger shows up. Now, when you look through the Bible, the arrival of an angel usually means that life is about to be tipped upside down. They come to deliver news that we didn't expect and often aren't very excited to hear. It's why their first words are usually, "Do not be afraid." God had a plan for Mary, a plan she wasn't expecting, a plan that seemed impossible. Now, interestingly, Mary seems to only have two questions about this. How will it happen? And why me? There is so much that she could have asked, and yet those are her only questions, which is a bit of a surprise, really, considering teenagers are usually full of them. Adults, on the other hand, tend to jump to conclusions and have opinions. There is a reason that we are called to be like little children. On a side note, the first thing that Mary does when the angel has gone is go to visit her cousin Elizabeth. She sought the counsel of someone she trusted, someone who would understand and would help, someone who would stand alongside her. When I think back to the circumstances surrounding my job change, I sought the counsel of wise friends. I did the CAP money course with Kat to see what the impact would be, and then I took a deep breath and trusted that God would catch me. God can handle our questions and our emotions. He doesn't want our excuses or opinions. Jim Rohn said, "Until you are willing to risk the ordinary, you will have to settle for the usual. Or to put it another way, feel the fear and do it anyway." Was Mary afraid? Yes. She was much perplexed, or other translations say greatly troubled. But despite this, she trusted God and willingly gave her consent. "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." This has to be one of the greatest statements of faith in the whole Bible. Do not underestimate the cost of Mary saying yes. Saying yes to God meant misunderstanding and public shame. Her reputation in tatters, her dreams dashed, ostracized from her community, having to face anger and contempt, the threat of death. Mary could have said no, but of one thing that she was certain, nothing is impossible for God. There were consequences to her decision, and she needed to cling to this certainty and trust God to see her through. God made it clear that he had chosen Mary for this massively important role, that she was highly favored. In the years to come, I wonder how hard it was for her to remember this. Amongst the heartache, opposition, the slander, the confusion, the anguish, the despair, and the loneliness. Mary's faith appears unwavering. Remembering the dramatic call of God on her life, she stood firm in her belief. Nothing is impossible to God. God is a God of the unexpected. The people of Mary's day were expecting God to do something. He had promised to save his people, but they expected someone to rescue them from occupying forces. They were expecting someone to throw out the Romans. They were expecting someone to give them hope in the face of oppression. They were expecting someone to rise up and overthrow the politicians. They lived in hope that God would do something and step in. And he did. But their expectations were shattered. They were turned upside down because instead of a mighty warrior, God sent a baby inside a teenage girl who was unmarried. Instead of power, there was vulnerability. Instead of a conquering warrior, a simple man. Instead of leading a rebellion, there was amazing sacrifice. Expectations were shattered, and yet what came through this baby was more profound. This bit of the story is all about Mary's response. "I'll do it." Her response of faith is a yes to shame and glory, a yes to God's power, and a yes to the impossible. Did she know what was going to be in store for her son? The life that he would lead and the death that he would die? She knew that God had chosen her, that she was highly favored. But how could she truly grasp what was about to happen? She was probably not certain of much, but of this she was certain. God was with her, and with God, all things are possible. And for now, that was enough. So what uncertainties are you facing? What fears and doubts? Has God perhaps already spoken to you about something? Have you asked him in prayer? Do you really, in your heart, trust that God is a supernatural God who has immeasurable power, who commands angels and can do anything that he wills, and that he utterly loves you and created you and wants life in all its fullness for you? How then do your fears measure up? When we're overconfident, we rely too much on our own strength. But when we're greatly troubled, sometimes all we can see is our weakness. But we are God's children, for whom he sent his only son, so that he could be with us always. Imagine if we all made our choices and lived our lives in the certainty of that, rather than the uncertainties of our own strengths and weaknesses. Let's use the example of Mary. Mary stands as a model of openness to God, as a model of faith in the face of natural doubt. What does God want from us? Well, exactly the same thing that he wanted from Mary: to trust him and have faith that he will keep his word in unlikely and unexpected ways. Let's pray. God, give us the strength, like Mary, to walk in the path that you have laid before us. We trust you, Lord, and believe that you are guiding us. Your word says that you will give us the next steps consistently, but our hearts waver at the same time. Strengthen us as we take steps of faith towards the plans that you have, however unexpected they may be. Amen. So we're going to continue in a time of response, and I want you to think about those things. What is God asking you to do? Is there something unexpected around the corner? What are your fears and uncertainties? What are your questions and your doubts? So we're going to take a moment to think. Whilst we're doing that, the band are going to play a song. It's a great song. We only ever sing it at Christmas, which I think is really sad. But it's a song about Mary and the choices that she made. And did she know what was going to happen next? So let's just take a moment to be quiet while the band sing.
Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? Child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand? Did you know your baby boy has won?
Bless you. Thanks so much for coming, and we hope to see you very soon. God bless. Bye for now.